Welcome everybody, we're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. We're gonna web scrape with Indeed job postings using Selenium. It's July 2023. The motivation for this, let me show you. 10 months now, I've been blocked from using this stupid website for web scraping because of this Cloudflare server. This annoying, stupid server. That's the motivation for this. In September of last year of 2022, when I was traveling a lot for work, I encountered this problem. People said, your video from June 2022, beautiful soup, doesn't work, what's the problem? Help me out. And I kept trying, had four IP addresses blocked. And I said, forget this, I'm done. I'll let someone else figure this out along the way. 10 months later, I figure out yesterday, yes, indeed, I am still getting this forbidden response. I'm blocked by this stupid website. Just trying to help people do some meaningful work in this world for data analytics. And they have this interesting thing, enable cookies. You've been blocked. This is a tactic such as using a CAPTCHA solver or checkbox to see if I'm human, things like this. This is one of the ways that they're trying to divert people from using Python or any kind of scrapers because maybe they see something in your header, maybe the way that you're making the response, it doesn't look like a human interaction, they saw that you did suspicious stuff on your IP address before, things like this. Probably all of those follow for me because I'm not a pro in this stuff. So I got all this and they give you this stupid response and tell you, hey, feel free to contact us. Here's your IP address that was blocked. Here's a reference number. Please contact us. Explain what you were doing when you ended up getting blocked. Do I think they're going to unblock me if I email them? Who knows? I have the ability to pull some of these jobs. It's not very fast, not fast at all. It's actually very slow. Out of spite, I have the ability to do it right now. And that's what I'm going to show you. I've compiled a great deal of information at the bottom of the citation. Please, please, please go to my GitHub, download this, read it, implement it, improve it, and help the community. Now that we got all that stuff out of the way, there's some really good things about Selenium. You could click boxes. You could do drop-down menus. You could emulate a human interaction. That's the thing that's important here. You could control the timing of your function call, when to actually click a button, load the page first, allow everything to load, wait a specific amount of time, then do your operations. This helps out a great deal. I'm not exactly sure how the implementation of request and beautiful soup work and why they're directly getting harassed by this indeed.com. I don't really know. If anyone knows the ins and outs, please leave it in the comments because I'm really interested. I patched together code from various places and then put some of my own stuff to have this work. If you've never used any of this stuff, pip install all this right now. Pause the video, grab all this, read all the side notes that I had for what each thing is doing because I don't physically have the time to do this because it would be a 40-minute video and people barely watch 2 minutes. I will tell you what I'm not using in this video. Since I can't use Beautiful Soup, I won't use that. I'm not using an E-tree or the CSV writer today. I am also not using multi-threading. That's going to be in a future video to improve the speed. And I want to talk about caveats and things to consider when you're web scraping on how it's actually implemented within your system. And I will not be thrown in a data frame. That's for you. I'm just showing you how to download this. It's important for me to let you know I'm using a newer version of Selenium. There are notation differences in the code. That's why I said this between 3 and 4. We're importing a web driver and I'm going to use Chrome. You could use Firefox or whatever you prefer. Just understand that you'll have to change the notation and do a little Googling to get that to work because that's not what I'm using today. This Chrome service is allowing me to do a start stop between the driver that we're calling. It's cool because I could say, hey, I want to go to this specific port or this location. We have this Chrome driver manager, which is allowing us to deal with any binaries, but you're not actually installing anything. This by is really important. If you ever use Beautiful Soup, think of like a find or find all method. That's what's going on with this. It's really useful. We could do CSS selectors. We could do call by a class name, various other things. We'll look at that real quick when we get into this. I'm not doing this today for this driver wait. That's pretty useful later to help you with the timing of your function calls to fine tune everything. I'm not using this as well today. That'll be in a future video. And I'm not using this, but it's pretty cool because it allows you to do keyboard movements on the web page. That's something I'll implement later, but I decided to avoid it just because of how slow this is already to process. You do have exceptions that get thrown and you need to take care of. Not all of them are necessary, but this is a common one. Consider using a headless browser just for speed. It doesn't open the new pop-up window when it's running the code, which is pretty cool. cool, but here are some of the issues, because you have some browsers that don't cooperate. Debugging is difficult because you're not actually seeing how this is implemented when the browser's open, seeing all the buttons and everything clicked. Some plugins are limited, and I mentioned this before. You could pause the video and read this, as well as what's really going on with this no such element exception. But essentially, this is trying to handle any kind of exceptions when you're loading data. And here's three more types of exceptions to look into. Please pause the video and read all this stuff at your own leisure, or download all the code from GitHub, please. I'm throwing a couple exceptions real quick right off the bat. I'm going into incognito mode. This is just starting out the driver with Chrome and allowing me to have some options. Here's a couple of the options that you can have here that are related to this. You could do also headless, but in the newer versions, this setup changed, and you'll see it below later. At this time, I chose not to iterate through all of these because I looked at data engineers in Washington, 10, 12 pages, 15 entries per page, and it takes minutes to process this. That's not really feasible. Then you have to start worrying about other issues of timing your request, because after about 30 or 40 pages, I started having issues with a pop-up that you have to click. That's another problem that you need to think about. This is something that's important that we'll be seeing shortly, and I'm going to get into that with the actual web page when we go into the code. That filter equals 0 and filter equals 1. Feel free to pause the video and read this real quick, but essentially you need to think about loading pages for your tasks and how to time those. You need to make sure that everything's loaded before you start running the next operation, because you may skip data because it wasn't loaded yet. You have to make sure what you're actually looking for is there, because you could have something that's hidden in an iframe. You could have hidden tags for some other information I'll show you later. It becomes really problematic when they start making things absent or completely hidden. You have to find ways to deal with that. At this time, I'm not very good with this, so I don't know. And exception handling. Later, to improve speed, this is something that you need to understand, the input versus the output. Basically, when you're web scraping, this is an input-output issue instead of a CPU-bound issue. So you could use multi-threading, but the best case scenario for something like that is using this, async IO. That's a lot better. But if this is too challenging for you to understand to implement for coding, just do a multi-threading for your CPU. Feel free to pause this to understand the distinctions between these. We need to look at what's going on. There's something that's really important. We're going to have a max number of pages which we could actually sift through for pagination. So going page to page to page. But this is actually deceiving, and I'm going to show you why. Something that I don't think anyone ever mentions or even pays attention to. Because this is an inaccurate depiction of what's going on, you're going to end up having the possibility of getting duplicate results, which could actually be quite a lot of results depending on your search term, especially data scientists in general for this whole state of California. You could have a couple thousand entries, and you could have 1,000 entries which are complete duplicate data. This right here is important, and I suggest you pause the video real quick, because that's how we're going to use this to do our iteration, because I'm kind of hacking this together instead of using a click button. This is the first essential part. We're going to grab our information. I wanted to time these operations so you get a clue. We're looking at data engineers for the state of Washington, and we're using this Chrome service with the driver manager, and we're doing an install with the option of incognito mode. Remember, I'm using Chrome. If you're using Firefox or anything else, you have to Google and figure out the implementation of that. The first page of it always starts at 0, and then it goes increments of 10. So it'll be 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, etc. And we're throwing in our location and our jobs for our pagination URL, or our original URL, which is this here with our input. And I'm making sure that we're sorting by the date. We're starting at a page 0. We have the filter 0, and I'll show you why. And then we have radius of 35 arbitrarily, 35 miles, you can get rid of that. And then here's our job and our location. This is used later in another video where we're going to use threading. I used a random integer between 2 and 10 for our sleep. You can do something more explicit with the other packages that we had before, like a weight or an explicit weight. Now, if you're new to web scraping, let's figure out what's going on here. So this go, right, indeed. And this is the amount of jobs for this search term. It says we have 176. So I'm going to click this. I'm going to do an inspect, and let's do something here. There. Now let's inspect this. We got to scroll up, and here is the job search pane that we're looking for right here. So you don't need everything with this CSS, none of that. You really only need this portion here, which you could copy. We're doing a CSS selector. If you wanted to do XPath, you just click this again, do copy, go down and do copy XPath, and it would look something like this. So this go, and here's the information. But if we did the XPath, it would look something like this, and you'd have to change this right here. and here's the options that you have, and you choose this from here. Let's do the class name. And what I'm doing is I'm going through this and it prints off as a string. So this becomes a string and it'll say 175 jobs. And I want the first element in that, which is the actual numerical value, which is the int. And we're going to do the division. We want to take basically the rounded down version of it, of 11 pages instead of 12. And this is actually the max number of pages that we're going to iterate through. Go back and let me show you why this is deceiving. So if you go to the bottom and you say there's 176 jobs, potentially, that's the max. There's 15 jobs per entry or page. Now you keep scrolling through all of this and we'll get to the end and we'll say, wait, there's only 9 pages. But 9 times 15 is less than 176 because 10 is 150. And then you read this and you say, oh, there's 54 hidden jobs which were actually duplicates. And this portion is problematic because I wanted to just scrape and pull this actual number and get the actual number of pages. As a hack. And you try to look at this, and if you pay attention, this is hidden information I can't exactly scrape. This is omitted, right? I tried to figure out how I could scrape this little piece and just take the numerical value and then just divide this number by 174, 179 and get the actual number of pages. I can't pull this. So you click this, and if you see something at the very top here, it says that filter zero. That filter zero now, if you go through, opens up and shows you all of the duplicate pages. And that's why I added it in my search query originally. Because look, now we have 12 pages. If you put that filter equal to 1, it'll go back to what you just saw, which was 8 or 9 pages. But unfortunately, stopping at that number is difficult because now your iterator isn't correct. And there's no way to get that correct. You're just going to have to filter now the duplicates, if that makes sense. That's the caveat, which is a problem here. Because when you're going page by page, the stopping point is difficult to know when to stop for your iterator using a loop. For me, I'm new to this. Maybe in the future it'd be easy. And I'll revisit this and tell you the workaround. But at this time, it was a problem for me because I'm not familiar with this. To close the pop-up window, you're using the driver.quit, and then we're stopping the timing. And this is how many seconds it took to pull this. But in the real time, when you're sitting in front of your computer, it seems like minutes. It's ridiculous. If you're interested in this kind of stuff, feel free to pause the video and learn about the XPath and the CSS selectors. There's some caveats between the notation and what's going on, and if it's directional or bidirectional, such as this. And how it works with the parent-child relationship for traversing the tree. Your wait times are extremely important. This is something I would consider putting in your code for something that's explicit to help you speed up the process later. Now, this part is the same, except we put some new list in that we want to capture our job information, the hrefs, which contain the job description, and then the salary requirements. So we're going to have to go through that one by one. We still have the same thing we had before here, except now we have our iterator for the pages where we're starting at 0, and the max floor value that we had before, which was 11. But we need to make sure up above that little parameter of filter equals 0 is relevant. And because you're starting at 0 and it goes in increments of 10, that's why we have this times 10 right here. I'm doing this as like a random sleep number, so we could basically let the page load, have a random amount of time go before we start processing our information. As of last year for the Mosaic job results, you're still working with your div ID, but this is the notation with your find element instead of find all or find method in Beautiful Soup. Let's go to the page. Just click this random job. Let's inspect it. Let's scroll up. So here's the job search beacon, job scene beacon that we're looking for. And scroll up a little bit. What's the outside of this? You say, oh, wait, these are all held within a list. You start scrolling. You say, oh, no, what's going on? Here's the Mosaic job results, which is the outermost portion containing all of the jobs. All of these jobs are held within all of these lists. Each one of these is one particular entry for the job. This is the last of it. So the scroll here, and here's the current entry that we're looking. There it is. Here's the current entry that we're interested in. And if you're wanting to pull the information from it, here's one good div class that you could pull it from right here. So that's what we're looking for. And we're taking this class name, storing it, and then we're iterating through all of this because we're taking elements and not element. Element takes one thing. This is at the outermost portion for all the jobs contained. Now you have 15 entries. That's where taking this is all of the elements, and you're iterating through this list of elements, and we're taking the job title. So let's find that job title. So here's that job title, and it's stored right in here in this in this heading, right? This header of H2. So here's the job title here, and you don't need this CSS lector information. And if you pay attention, this href here is this clickable link right here, which will get you to the next page that has the full version of the job description, which we'll do a click on. There's two different options of how you're going to pull that information. So after you grab the job title, we have our job title and we're converting it into text. The next thing that we want to find is we could take this reference ID, which is going to be the same thing as that href that we were looking for. And it's hidden in this A tag. We're using the CSS selector to grab that. So if you see, there's the A tag right here that holds our href that we want to pull for that clickable link. We're going to take the company name, the company location, and the date it was posted. So we click down and you see here's the company location and it's hidden right here in this class of company name. We have the company location hidden in this class. And then we got the salary, which is not always available and you have to use exceptions. So that's hidden in here. You open that and you see this metadata salary snippet. You don't need the metadata part. You could cut and paste this is which we're going to use coming up. And here is the same thing as this. This is a duplicate. So I should cut this out. This is a duplicate entry. The salary snippet, I removed the metadata I just showed you. This piece of code I snagged from somewhere else, and I'm not sure if this is still relevant or not. You could browse around and peruse and see if this is still relevant. And I think you could get by with these not showing this exception. I took this out of the loop, which is the job descriptions, because this is the most time consuming, but you could keep it all together with inside this loop. So you're not reopening new browser windows, which I would probably suggest just because of time's sake. The alternate version of doing the job description. Here's the first one since we separated it out of that loop. Here's what we're doing, separating out of the loop. All of this is the exact same. This is clicking the actual button of the job title on the posting. This button right here. This is the actual thing that you're trying to click, which is this. To go to the link, which stores the information for the job description here, which we want to actually pull. But if you notice, it's held within all these P tags. This is the information we're going to pull by this ID, and that's what we're pulling here. Do you need a try except here? I don't think so, because they should all have a job description. But for some instance, if you have a problem with it not loading or something happened, you have that exception. I put this time because if I put it shorter, I noticed the entries that are at the end of my search, I had issues with it pulling and scraping the text. You may even need to increase this depending. This is a situation where I would have an explicit wait or action chain saying, hey, call this driver, after that driver, do this explicit action followed by blah, blah, blah. That's an option that I would suggest. And then we're kicking out of the driver. When you're using the incognito mode, the search results are different than the regular browser. Pay attention to this when you're doing comparison testing for your work, because you will have discrepancies. The option two is a little bit different. This is really like the third option, because the first one integrated everything together in the loop. The second one did the job description second, but did the click button. This one is not using a click button, but instead doing the same information for the iteration. But now we're looping through only the href links. We're not doing anything where we're clicking from a browser tab. We're going directly from the link that we pulled and pulling the information. And I decided to try it with incognito and headless. I don't know if this is necessary if you're using headless anymore. I don't know how that works. We're calling the link that we're grabbing, which is one of the hrefs. We're having that wait time and we're pulling that text. This is different than before, because before we're pulling the text after we click the link. This is only using a list of links. But look at the time. This is incredibly slow. It's like 20 minutes to pull 100 and something postings. That's stupid slow. You could get this down to half the time by doing threading. And then you should be able to get a considerable difference using the async IO, which I'll perform in a future video. Here's an example of some of the text from one of the job descriptions. And here's something from the threading. I don't think this is completely right, but here's the timing to suggest that it is worthwhile to add threading or async IO. It's up to you to throw this into a data frame, remove any duplicates, do some plotting, and consider natural language processing for future work. Improvements for this. You need to speed this up. It's incredibly slow. Async IO is your best option. The next is threading. If you could get this async IO and then try to maximize this, clean up the data, put it in your DF, do plotting, blah, 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 like I said. Here's my socials. Feel free to hit me up. But as always, like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. Thank you for everyone who's gave positive encouragement, asked me to help them out over the years. I greatly appreciate it. Please consider supporting the channel if you can with super thanks, buy me a coffee, become a channel member. It really helps out because this stuff takes a lot of time. I know they're not the best videos, but I try my best. Thank you. Bye.